one who graduates today and stops learning tomorrow becomes illiterate the day after. So learning is the continuous process of life. Till you become one with the knowledge, learning does not stop. All are students of life, learning things from life. Life is the best teacher. And how does life teach you? Live it forward and experience it backward, or learn it backward. First you experience and then you derive what exactly it is about. Life is a teacher of a different sort. Being a student is the best thing that can happen to anyone in one's life. The one who cannot be a student has not lived at all. He's as dead as a piece of rock lying there. Only those who are students, in the sense those who are eager to learn, they alone learn and they alone live. All others are dead because they have no interest in learning, they have no efforts to be made, and they have no goal, no vision. Such people are best called dead. That is why mrutyo, samrutyo, from death to death they go, not life to life. Because they have not learnt anything in the life, so they are as good as dead. Learning is such a wonderful blessing of God to everyone. To learn is to live. If you stop learning, you stop living. That's as straight and simple as that. Until when you learn, till you become one with the knowledge, till then the learning does not stop. Therefore, everybody is a student outside the class, inside the class. Everyone is first the student of life, then the student of a lecturer. And if we have learned everything that the lecturer has told and missed all the teachings of life, then we have not learned well. Aparavidya, paravidya. All that you learn in a classroom by a lecturer, all aparavidya. Paravidya happens in life, with the experiences of life. That's when you start learning the true lessons of life, that is paravidya. You look at nature, you look at the sunrise, the sunset, look at the birds, look at water, look at air. That is why Dattatreya said, I learned from 24 gurus. And all his gurus are what? Bee, elephant, fish, some insects, birds, tree, it goes on. Snakes. These are the ones whom he has learned from, Dattatreya said. Because he's roaming around in the forest. He doesn't have a classroom set up, nobody to come and teach. Definitely no online classes in those days. So whom does he learn from? Should he stop becoming a student? Should he stop learning because there is no teacher around? No online, no facilities? No. As he moved around, he observed and witnessed everything that was around him. And he learnt and learnt and learnt his lessons. He learnt from everyone everything. And 24 teachers he attributes all his wisdom to. And Shankaracharya also in his Viveka Chudamani says, 5 teachers that teach us, he talks about them. Kuranga, the deer, it's tempted by sound. So the hunter hunts the deer by making some rustling sound of the leaves. And the deer is unable to resist. It wants to know where the sound is coming from and gets caught. Just because of one faculty of hearing, the deer is caught. So he understood, I must be careful what I listen to. Otherwise my fate is going to be like that deer, which was so happily jumping around and playing, living a happy free life. Suddenly, because it got tempted, because of one sense organ of hearing, it got caught. So Dattatreya also learned the lesson, I must be careful of what I lend my ears to. It is in my hand. Ears on their own don't go and listen to anything. You take the ears and you put these things inside the ears. Matanga, elephant. What does it do? A male elephant is caught in the forest. He's a male elephant. See, anybody who is, in Hindi they say, who is very carefree, they call him mast, hathi jaisa mast hai. He is happy-go-lucky like a male elephant. Even Dattatreya is described as an elephant. The way he walks and carelessly without fear. Dattatreya also is described in that same scripture, Bhagavatam, as an elephant. Carefree elephant. But what happens? A female elephant is sent into the forest. In fact, that is an old method of catching elephants. They'll make a dummy elephant, a doll elephant, and cover it with elephant skin. And this elephant will think that's a female elephant who is waiting for me. And they will dig a big pit under and cover it with shallow leaves and some twigs and put this doll elephant on top, covering with an elephant skin. And this full big male elephant who was happily roaming around suddenly gets tempted and goes and falls into the pit. Or they send a female elephant into the forest. She gently goes in. Hi, hello, how are you? The male elephant. Oh, who are you? So beautiful. I never seen something like you. Can I come with you? Of course, come. Takes him all the way into the hunter's house. And after that, the male elephant has no job but keep carrying logs and logs throughout his life. He's slogging, logging. Why? Because he got tempted with touch. One sense touch, wrongly touched, you're done for life. Kuranga, matanga, patanga, the moth. Now it knows if it goes near the fire, it'll get burnt. And this is not the first time he's seeing. He saw his father, grandfather, great-grandfather, everybody burnt in the same fire. Yet it cannot resist. Driven by the senses, goes and falls straight into the same fire in which whole of his lineage is burnt. Yesterday, day before. But it can, though it knows it is so fatal, yet it cannot control its temptation. One sense, that is the sight, sees the fire, straight goes into it and burns and dies. Meena, fourth, fish. How do we catch fish? You put another bait in the water on a fish hook. And then the fish comes. It knows. Yesterday my grandmother was caught. Mother was also caught through this bait. And this is a bait. Yet look at its desire to taste. Knowing fully well that it is a trap. It goes and tries to think it will outsmart the hook and take away the bait and save itself. It thinks it will outsmart the world. Outsmart Maya. No. It goes and correctly puts its mouth there, gets cut. Evening dinner, fish fry. Happily it was roaming in the river. Nobody to ask, nobody to report to, nobody to work. Because of its one temptation of tasting, gets caught and it is done for life. At least elephant is alive, fish is done by end of the day. Bhrunga, bee. The nectar in the flower, the smell, nose of this bhrunga, it cannot resist. The moment it smells this flower has nectar, however dangerous it might be to go in, it goes in straight into and the flower closes and this bhrunga is caught there and dies. So Shankaracharya says, so also Dattatreya said, these are the lessons I learned from all of them, to control my eyes, ears, nose, tongue and skin, that is touch. Because these animals taught me this lesson, how dangerous it is with one sense of theirs, which is out of control or which is so difficult for them to resist, all of them meet a fatal end. They ruin themselves. Mahati vinishtaha, vinashtihi. They are dead now. Man, Shankaracharya says, naranam, all the five are there. Pancha biranchita kim, what is the fate of a man? Who has all these five senses all working together, competing in fact with each other to take control. What is the fate of a man if all these animals were bound by their gunas, swagunena baddha, these are vasanas, these are the instincts which are deep embedded in us from many, many births. If these animals die because of one single sense organ which is not in their control, and they are driven by them, what is the fate of man who is driven by all the five senses? So vasana, as he said, is very, very true. It is true. And vasanas are like the seeds. But if you burn the seeds in the fire of jnana, the seeds become impotent, that they will not be able to grow. That is what jnana agni, that is what Ramakrishna would say. You fry the seeds in the fire of jnana, then they lose their potency. They will not be able to grow again. Otherwise, there is every possibility that they will grow again. Prabhavo apyayo, yogo hi prabhavo apyayo. Yoga, even samadhi, is prabhavo. It can come, it can go back. You will come down the same slide as you went up. It is possible, that is what they want. So what is the end, what is the final, how do we get over it? Atmaikya bodhena binapi mukti na labhyate. Without realizing who you are, this idea of liberation from your own self, your senses, your mind, not possible at all. Very emphatically, Shankaracharya says, do what you want. Bhajantu devata, vadantu shastrani, yajantu devanam, kurvantu karmani. Whatever you do, do bhajan, do action, do all kinds of, read Vedas and scriptures. Do anything that you want and praise God's atmaikya bodhena, without realizing who you are, no mukti. How much? Brahma shatantarepi. In 100 years of Brahma also, it is not possible to free yourself from the clutches of vasanas and the deep-rooted desires which have been chasing us, following us since the very beginning. Anadi, he said, from the very beginning. These are there. So only when you are able to overcome that do you find mukti. Samadhi is a small escape. Escape from this for a few minutes or a few moments, maybe half a day, 2 days, depends. But once that is over, you are back in the same thing. But one and only solution, ultimate solution to this is realization. That alone puts an end to all the vagaries of mind, all the vasanas, and there is no coming back from there. You are transformed, you are already transformed into another. I give the example of mercury transformed into gold. Its nature changes. There is no way you can get tempted by the same thing again. How? How come? Because you have grown up like a child who has grown up. You cannot tempt him with dolls and the child says, I am not a kid to play with dolls anymore, Amma. I have grown up. Give me some tab or some mobile or something. It's not tempted by the same doll. Why? Because it's grown up, its nature has changed. Likewise, when our nature changes from human to divine, our ideas, attitudes, our likes, dislikes, preferences, lifestyle, whatever we call, everything will undergo a drastic change. And then the same things which you were falling for, which you thought you could never overcome, could never resist, which you thought that's what is life and death for you, those things will look unimportant. They will look, in fact, useless. They'll think, and you will look back at yourself and think, you mean to say, I was like this? Some children, you click their picture in their childhood, especially without clothes, and you show them when they grow up, they'll be so angry with you. How dare you do this to me? Why? Because they realized, they've grown up. Likewise, when they were kids, they were running around all the place, all around, without the care. When they grow up, they realize, no, it can't be this way. Likewise, you will put your hands on your face and you'll think, don't tell me that I was like this. Don't tell me this is my photo. You will say like this. Why? Because you have grown up and you realize that was not the way it should have been. Anyway, for kids, it's fine. But you should not, because you have lived like this so many births. So again, this birth also did the same thing. At the time of departure, these thoughts will come. And then you'll realize, oh, I did the same thing again in this birth. How shameful, how shameful. How so very embarrassing. How so very silly, foolish, ignorant of me to have just repeated the same thing which I did before, made a mistake. I thought I will not make it again. And inadvertently, I made the same mistake again. And one more lifetime is lost. And at the end, Shraddha Kale, you are looking back at your life and think, this is what I did with my life. Oh, what a waste, what a pity, what a pity. You'll feel guilty, you'll feel ashamed of yourself because we have not done what was to be done. We spent all the time doing something else. So that is the kind of realization of a soul who departs. What is the point? After examinations have come and you have not studied, what is the point? You're anyway going to fail. You have to repeat the class. There is no other way. That is why it says, start early, drive slowly, reach safely. Start as early as possible on the spiritual path, because that is the path that needs to be practiced. How much time it should be practiced? Oh, you all were very happy. I said, 9 seconds into 9 seconds into 9 seconds. How many people have achieved that 9 into 9 into 9? And that samadhi is not 1.5 minutes. That's only dharana, dhyana. Dhyana, samadhi is beyond that. 9 into 9 into 9, I said samadhi. That will be approximately 12 minutes or something like that. 12 minutes, if you can keep your mind focused on one thing, that is the state of samadhi, I said. Not always. First time you might have to practice. After 100 practices like this, it may just take a second to go into that state at your switch on and off, remote. It is in your hand. But till then, this practice is required. Even if this practice is required, what happens? Why this practice should be done? When you say, even if you practice this, there is no guarantee. You'll again slip back to the same state if another temptation comes. Vishwamitra, Menaka arrived, he forgot all his 1,000 years of tapas. Puyogo hi prabhavapyayo. Even you attain that samadhi state for a day or two, or half a day or 1 minute, nothing is guaranteed, no guarantee that you will not slip back into your old ways, old habits, die hard. So there is no guarantee. The only guarantee by all scriptures, all rishis, all munis, all Vedantins have told is, when you realize who you are, then the guarantee is permanent. Otherwise, 1 year warranty, 2 year warranties will be, lifetime warranty is not there. With these siddhis and samadhis, it's not lifetime warranty. The only lifetime is, and life's times, for all lives to come is, atmaikya bodha, when you realize who you truly are. If you spend 23 hours, after that, I hope 50 minutes, 40 minutes, 30 minutes, practicing ajnana, avidya, distractions. So you will naturally get good at it, right? 20 minutes you have practiced meditation in a day. 23 hours, 40 minutes, you have practiced avidya, distraction. Now somebody who practices something, let's say piano, somebody who practices 23 hours, 40 minutes piano, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, and whatever 30 years of his life, what would be his level of expertise in playing piano? Imagine, he will beat our Dimitri's left hand, you know, outright. Because he has practiced 23 hours, 40 minutes, what? Piano. So naturally, he'll be very good at playing piano. So if you in your life are practicing 23 hours, 40 minutes, this idea that your body, this your mind, all these emotions, these relations, this identification, how 20 minutes of meditation is going to undo, tell me? How the balance will tilt this side? How is it possible? It's not possible because you are only practicing what is not for longer time, and what you are practicing it for a very little time. So what does Swami say? Oh, so should we do meditation all day long? Even if you try, you won't be able to do. Once 4 monks got together, said, let us meditate. 2 weeks, like I told, maunam, no talking. 2 weeks, pledge, no, none of us will talk, we'll meditate. So first night, you know, they sat down, 4 of them, lit a candle and started meditating on the candle. Jyoti meditation. The candle blew off. The first monk said, oh my God, candle blew off. The second one said, what should we do now? The third one said, why you people are talking? The fourth one said, I am the only one not talking. So if I tell you, no, tomorrow onwards, half a day minimum meditation. Only when you're sleeping or you're in the office, do your work. All the rest of the time, just meditation. What will happen? I'm the only one meditating, you will tell. In the ashram, I am the only one not talking. Our vasanas, swagunayana baddha, it won't allow us. Why? Because you have practiced it so many times, so much time. For births and births we have practiced, at least in this birth, 20 minutes you are practicing. In all the births before this, 24 hours you have practiced the same thing. So how do you want to undo it with for 20 minutes of meditation a day? Or 20 minutes of Maunam a day? Or 20 minutes of Atma Vichara? It will take longer, it will take much more time than this. Why I am saying is our 30-day workshop is coming to an end now. I am not saying you have attained Samadhi, not attained Samadhi, that is the sign of your success or failure. No. Samadhi was not even the, it was a milestone, it was not the destination, first of all, that you should get it very clear. It was only a milestone. To tell you why Samadhi, because the joy of Samadhi is so much more sweeter. So when you experience a higher pleasure, a higher joy, naturally your temptations for lower ones will at least decrease, if not completely annihilated, it will reduce. It means the frequency of you indulging in lower pleasures will diminish because you have another way to escape to a higher pleasure. Another way is there to enjoy without putting any effort, actually no effort. For even to enjoy some food, you have to go till the food court. I don't know whether you'll enjoy or not, but at least you go to the food court. And there's a special item is made that day, you're happy. Then what you have to do? All you done the walking, then you have to find a plate, find a place. Then you have to give a smile to the one who's serving so that he serves an extra helping. After that, you will take the plate, come to a corner peacefully. You don't want others to come and disturb you while you're eating. You want a quiet corner. How much effort is that to enjoy that ananda, anna ananda? How much effort? You have to walk, go there, pick the plate, get queue is there, and then eat, and then digest it also, all that you have eaten. Otherwise it will create stomach problem, then your ananda is gone. Everything, such a big work, what meditation, what effort is there? Find a quiet corner, everywhere it is quiet here. You are not in a city, traffic, pollution, people, a house full of relatives. Every now and then the neighbor comes and knocks. None of this is there. In fact, here I have told, if a neighbor comes and knocks, you knock him down. Don't allow anybody to come and disturb you. You do your meditation, they do their meditation. There's no gossiping and socializing here. We are here for spiritualizing ourselves, not socializing here. So you find a quiet corner, sit down, meditate. Meditate 20 minutes, 30 minutes, 40 minutes, whatever time you can afford. It means you have to provide this time from some other practices. So what I'm saying is provide this time to meditation from other practices of I am the body, I am the body, I am the mind, I am the body, I am the mind. That is what you're practicing. Now take that time away from that and put it that time into your meditation. I am divine, I am divine. Take the time of your sleep and put it here into meditation. And you will see you don't need so much of sleep. You'll realize after some time. You don't need so much of sleep. They say yoga nidras, you know. Rishis, munis, they hardly sleep. Why? Because they're yogis, they're never tired. They're always energized. You will not need so much of food. In fact, food will not be the driving force in your life. Right now, we are driven by food. Stuck in the annamaya kosha. All the time. So breakfast gets over, the next thought in the mind is lunch. Lunch gets over, the next thought in the mind is snacks. Snacks gets over, next thought in the mind is dinner. Now we are living life between lunch, breakfast, lunch, snacks and dinner. Life is, that's all, between this lunch. That can't be the way. But then you will realize as you start living, oh, the food comes, it's fine. Tasty food, fine. If it's all right, also fine. Everything will be fine with you. You will learn that changes that come inside you. You're no more driven by senses. You're always driven from consciousness, which is in all. See that cuckoo? It's happy. Anyway, so all I'm saying is that Brahman, the idea of consciousness everywhere, that you have to keep practicing. How long you should practice? Till you have realized you must practice. How long you are a student of this class? Till you have become a master, you are a student. You have to keep practicing, keep practicing. Don't say that I practiced 20 minutes, 30 days I've over. Where is my Atma realization, self-realization? It's not going to come. one sannyasi monk, Buddhist monk, it seems he went up the hill to practice meditation and realize whatever, nirvana. So 6 years he practiced and got fed up. 6 years nothing happened. At least 6 years he has practiced whatever. Then he came down. He thought, so much I worked hard, what is the use? They have not realized Brahman or nirvana. They don't have Brahman, they have shunya or nirvana. As he came down, he saw a man sitting with a huge iron rod, like we have for digging that crowbar, and one silk cloth, and he's rubbing that iron rod very, very hard. So he asked him, what is that you're doing? Oh, my wife asked for a needle. I don't have a needle, so I'm making a needle out of this rod, he said, by scraping it with silk cloth. He understood, went back to the mountain, started meditating again. Why? So much of vasanas are there. So many births, 23 hours, in fact 24 hours also possibly we have practiced only, I am the body, I am the mind, I am the body, I am the mind, I am the body, I am the mind. In this birth, in a lockdown period of 30 days, by practicing that kachapaka 20 minutes a day, you will attain Brahman, then the rod will become a needle. How is it possible? So there is much more to life. 24 hours, you should be meditating only on this thought that I am Brahman, I am divine. That is my true nature. Body, mind are instruments. Karana, they call it, instruments. That is Bahir Karana, this is Antakarana. Bahir Karana means all these limbs. Antakarana is mind, buddhi, chitta, Antakarana. They're all instruments which I have to use. I am not them. They are not me. They belong to me. That's all is my connection and relation with them. And I must use them as I require. A needle is required, needle should be used. Knife is required, knife should be used. Just because you have legs, it doesn't mean that you keep walking all the time, isn't it? So just because you have tongue, you have to keep talking all the time. Just because of your ears, you have to keep listening all the time. Seeing all the time. No, not necessary. When it is necessary, then if you can use your body, mind, intellect, then you're a yogi. Because you control yourself. They don't control you. Animals are driven by instincts. Their body controls them. Their minds control them. Their instincts control them. As humans, we have an upper hand. We have the ability to control our minds, our bodies. But everything needs practice. Even to balance on a bicycle needs practice. Like that abhyasa. Back to square one. Practice, practice, practice. Three secrets of success. Practice, practice, practice. Abhyasa yogena. Practice this yoga, abhyasa. Abhyasa, Krishna said in Bhagavad Gita, same thing, mind control. Same thing, abhyasa, vairagya, tannirodha. By abhyasa in vairagya, you can. Same Krishna says, abhyasa, vairagya. Abhyasa, vairagya, patanjali. That is the way forward. So 30 days are getting over. We have done a fantastic job ourselves. Don't pat yourself because you only practice 20 minutes meditation. And 23 hours, 40 minutes you have practiced what you are not. So obviously you are super at it. You are experts at believing you are the body. 20 minutes of daily practice, no meditation will happen. And they're so peaceful here. Imagine if this was any other place, the midst of a city. That too in those pigeonhole apartments of Mumbai you should see. Those who say he stays there. I was telling them a nice joke. In Mumbai there is no accommodation for anybody. It's so expensive. I went to somebody's house. The house is just one room. That is the drawing room. That is all the bedroom. And I thought there is one more bedroom. They said, no Swami, this is all it is. Where do I sit? He said, this is where you sit. Where do I eat? This is where you have to eat. Luckily there was another bathroom. Small kitchen. Where a lady of ordinary size can turn around. Extraordinary size, XXL, no scope. Same bathroom also. A man of MS size can use the washroom. XXL is stuck. I was looking at all this, I think this is 1 crore rupees he told for this apartment. My heart sank. I said, 1 crore rupees for this pigeonhole? He said, yes. And that is Mumbai. So the joke was that one man wanted to get married and settle down in Mumbai. So his friend said, why don't you get married now? You're quite old. He said, I want to get married, but where will I stay after marriage? He said, oh, I can't afford an apartment and place. He said, that's not a big deal. You go and stay in your father-in-law's place. He said, I could have done that, but my father-in-law is already staying in his father-in-law's place. All the Trishankus of Mumbai, Bangalore, Chennai ran away from the Swarga. Means they themselves kicked themselves out of the Swarga. That's how it is. And 30, 40 days stuck in that apartment in Mumbai or Bangalore or wherever, struggled. Here, such a peaceful environment. Everything is so beautiful. I sit down in the morning, I just watch the birds going about doing their business, you know, flying from this. And I notice we have so many different kinds of trees, therefore so many different kinds of birds. How beautiful. And then I remember Mundaka Upanishad, two birds sitting on a tree, one eating the berries and which are bitter and sweet, and one peacefully sitting, watching as a witness to everything. I remember when I see these birds, immediately there is a dhyana of Brahman. Ah, that bird is me, this bird is the lower jiva, which I think I am the body, mind and struggling. The upper bird is so peacefully sitting. This lower bird is restless, running around this way, that. I realize that. When I see this tree and the birds coming back to their nests in the evening, you see, there's a mango tree opposite window. All these birds towards the evening will start coming back. I remember how today Prashnoparishad is going on, how they explain in the deep sleep state, all the senses and the mind go back to the Brahman. Like the birds that come back to their nests in the evening. I see that, I said, oh, there is Brahman in this idea. All our senses and minds get absorbed in Brahman when we are in deep sleep. Like the birds come back to their nests at the end of the day to rest. Rest is only in Brahman. Only when we become one with that, there is peace, there is rest. Tesham sukham shashvati. For others, it is not there. It's told so clearly. So many Upanishads, somewhere in every Upanishad, this sentence or a similar sentence will appear. That there is no other way to be happy, to be peaceful, to be restful, other than realizing who you are. And how will we realize with these 20 minutes of effort? Huge iron crowbar we have. With a piece of silk, we are trying to make a needle out of it. That to be 20 minutes effort today. That man was doing all day, all long. You would have taken Brahma Shatantarepi to make a needle out of it for sure. We are sitting with these many vasanas, ideas, attachments, false identifications. And we want to make a needle out of it in no time. 30 days it will happen. No. It's not going to happen. So should we disappoint ourselves and go back to our old ways saying this is not for me? Sour grapes? Or should we work further saying that, yes, we have started, we have begun our journey. At least we were going in the wrong road. Now we at least have found the right road. Okay, so what if you have to go a long distance? At least I am on the right road. So keep walking. Ekla chalo. Keep walking alone. If nobody is walking, also walk on this path alone, Rabindranath Tagore said. Keep walking. Till when? Till you reach. So this exercise of these 30 days should have made the sleeping awaken. The awakened, sit up. The sitting, stand. The standing, walk. The walking, reach. The reaching, merge. So you might have been in different states. Some were sleeping, they just got woken up. Some were awake, they sat up. Some were sitting, they have stood up. Some were standing, they have started walking. Some were walking, probably they are running now, rushing. Some were running, they are reaching. Some who are almost reaching, they'll merge. Yatha karma, yatha shrutam. As you have practiced, as you have believed, that will guide your life to your destination. Ultimately, destiny is one and the same for all. All have to become divine. Realization must come to everyone today or tomorrow. Someday it has to come. Even if you want to escape it, somehow it will chase you and it will come. But whether you want to have it now and be free from all this little temptations, you know, like these little animals bound by our instincts, or live life free, abound. That choice is in our hand. That is not in anybody's hand. So that choice we must exercise. How? Just these 20 minutes, 15 minutes, it was just a beginning, starting, like beginner's level. The advanced level means life should become meditation. Effortlessly, all the time you're absorbed in the thought that I am divine only, and then go about doing what you have to do. This stanza from Ashtavakra. Antar vikalpa shunyasya. Inside there is no thought, nothing happening. You are steady like the deep ocean. Bahi swachhanda charina. Outside you are roaming around like a carefree elephant. That should be the status of a yogi. A real jnani is inside, absolutely untouched by all that happens outside. Like the ocean. Waves are forming, falling, rising, falling. Deep inside ocean is absolutely peaceful. Nobody can touch. Nobody can disturb its peace. As many rivers may flow into it, let them flow. As much of water gets evaporated, let it get evaporated. Neither it swells nor it shrinks. Stays steady. That becomes the nature of that person who is constant integrated awareness, completely absorbed in that one thought that I am only divine, everything is only divine. This is all a play. This is a play of nature. Goes on and on and on. And I play along. But deep inside, untouched, unperturbed, uninvolved. Outside goes on acting according to the need of the hour. But how? Carefree, swachhanda charina, not bound by an obligation or a sense of duty, but doing it because that's his nature to do. A river's nature is to flow. It doesn't do it because it's a duty to for the river to flow and, you know, irrigate so many fields and give water to so many. If that happens on the way, well and good. My nature is to flow. My nature is to help. My nature is to be compassionate. My nature is to be kind. My nature is to be genuine. My nature is to be honest, truthful. My nature is to be divine. And all activities, my head, hands, everything will follow the source from which this wisdom is coming. So your worship will attain a new meaning. You look at God not as the form with name. You look at God beyond that. Your worship will go to the next level. Your work will go to the next level. It won't be work anymore. Work will become worship. Worship will become wisdom. By virtue of this new realization. So work is worship, easier said. How to make work truly worship when you have wisdom only? That realization will transform all work into worship on its own, because you see everybody is God. Sarva bhuteshu chatmanam. All are gods. Whomsoever I serve God only. So work has become worship. Any work you do is worship. Even eating, sleeping will become worship. Brahma arpadam, worship. Nidra shayana seva, you'll think. The divine in me needs rest. The whole concept of life will undergo tremendous change. So we have heard all these concepts. Swami has spoken it for any number of years, in simple terms. How many of us sat down and chewed on it and understood how deep, how much is there inside that? How many of us? We have not done. That is why we are still where we are. So the only way out of this whole maze, of this whole thing, is Atma Siddhi. That comes from Chitta Shuddhi. Chitta Shuddhi is the product of Seva, Sadhana, Bhakti. Once the heart becomes pure, it reflects the divine effortlessly. No effort. From the times like these where you are doing meditation to the times where meditation happens, you must continue. Every time, little time you get 20 minutes, I must rush back to my state of meditation. That should be your temptation. Anando brahmeti vyajanat. I learnt Ananda is Brahman, means closest to Brahman, is a reflection of Brahman. Everybody wants Ananda. Somebody who says, I don't want to be happy, if there is anybody who let me know, I have a lot of ways to make you miserable. I want to be happy. That is the basic core reason why everybody is alive. When we eat, we want to be happy. Who wants to eat unpleasant food? When we go around, we want to be happy. Who wants to see unpleasant things? When we meet somebody, we want to be happy. Who wants to meet unfriendly people? When we work, we want to be happy. Who wants to do things that will bring misery to us? Everybody wants happy. Where is this happiness? Ananda Valli, So beautifully, I says, if you want happiness, Manushyananda, one unit of Manushyananda, it declares how. Yuva syat sadhu, yuva dhyayakah, ashishto, balishto, dhudishtah, tasyeva ek manushanandah. One unit of Manushya's ananda requires what? Yuva, you should be youthful. That is not possible, someday we'll grow old. Sadhu, you should be a good person all the time. That is not possible, sometimes we are good, sometimes bad. Dhyayakaha, you should be learner, meditator. Ashishto, balishto, dhudishtaha. You should have good desire, very powerful and noble desires. Ashishto, balishto, you should be strength, not a heavyweight championship bodybuilder, but he should be strong in his body. His limbs are not frail and failing. Dhudishtaha, you should be a determined young man. What kind of a young man or a woman? You should be strong in the body, ashishta, good thoughts, good desires you should have. Dhrishta, determined, should be young. And sadhu, should be a good man also. Then, what else is required? Tasyesham, prithvim, sarva. All this earth you should rule. Vittasya, purnaj. All the wealth in the world also should belong to him. He should be young, he should be good, he should have good desires, should be strong, body and mind and spirit. Such a person, when he has all these with him, he is considered as a happy man according to Vedas. He alone, that is one unit of happiness of a man. Or else, you will ask me, this is impossible. It means I can never be a happy man, a happy woman in life because the requirements are like sky high. So who is going to be happy? Scriptures say, Shrotriyasya cha akamahatasya. Either you be this, or the other choice is Shrotriyasya cha akamahatasya. You be the believer of the Vedas. You be the knower of the Vedas, Shrotriya, and akamahata, desireless person. That is equivalent to having all these things, says Upanishad. How is it possible to attain all this? Then it goes on. 10 to the power 20 is Brahmananda. Like he says, Manushyananda comes 100 times Manushyananda. Te ye shatam Manushyananda. What happens? That is Eka Gandharva, Manushya Gandharvananda. And what is 100 times Manushya Gandharvananda? Sa Eko Deva Gandharvananda. And what is multiplied 100 by Devagandharvana Ananda? That is Pitranam Chiraloka Lokanam Ananda. What is multiplied 100 by that? That is equivalent to Ajana Jana Devanam Ananda. Multiplied by 100 is Devana Devanam Ananda. Multiplied by 100 is Devanam Ananda. Karma Deva and Devana. Multiplied by 100 is Indriyasya Ananda. Multiplied by 100 is Prajapati Rananda. Multiplied by 100 is Brihaspati Rananda, then Prajapati Rananda, and finally multiplied 100 is Brahmananda. So look at the sequence. 10 to the power 20 of Manushyananda is equal to Brahmananda. And you are all saying 20 minutes meditation. I must attain Brahmananda. How is it possible? So another thing is there. The Upanishads, here at least they gave us a second way. If this was the only way, then we are done. But Upanishad says, otherwise, Shrotriyasya cha kamahatasya. Be a Shrotriya, knower of the Vedas, believer of the truths of Vedas, experiencer of the truth of Vedas, and desireless. You will have the same ananda. Every time it says, Shrotriyasya cha kamahatasya, every time it repeats, Sa eko manushya gandharva anandaha, Shrotriyasya cha kamahatasya. Te yeshatam manushya gandharva naam anandaha, Sa eko deva gandharva anandaha, Shrotriyasya cha kamahatasya. At every step, the Shrotriyasya cha kamahatasya repeats, all 10 times it repeats. To tell you that any level of ananda is equal to this ananda. What ananda? Shrotriyasya cha akamahatasya. The knowledge of the truth, realization of the truth and desirelessness. This is equivalent in ananda to all the ananda that you could. Even one unit of manushyananda is not possible for everybody here. How will you have 10 to the power 20 units of Manushyananda, which is equal to one Brahmananda? And I am saying you are not even Brahmananda, you are beyond that. that Brahmananda is samadhi sthiti. And you are supposed to be beyond that. Then why all this effort, you will say? Because this is what will dissuade you from pursuing practice of distraction for 23 hours, 40 minutes a day. This is what will motivate you, encourage you to seek that. After attaining which, there is nothing more to be attained. This is what will make your life worthwhile. Therefore, practice this. For whose sake? For your own good sake. You're not doing a favor to anybody, not to me the least. But do a favor to yourself. So increase your intensity, as he said, intensity of practice. There should be all 60 seconds in a minute. There should be all 60 minutes in the hour. There should be all 24 hours in the day. There should be all 7 days in your week. There should be all 365 days in your year. That kind of intensity. Complete involvement in this practice of trying to realize. Any little slackish effort is like, you know, silk cloth and crowbar. That's all you should think of. You'll carve a needle out of it for all the things. So this ashram should set an example. By the residents of this ashram and all those people who are now in Trishanku Swargas, and as and when they end up here by the grace of the government, they should come and get a shock. What has happened to all these people? They were not like this. They should call you, come, let us have a chat. You say, just give a smile. What happened to you? Somebody irritates you, just give a smile. Oh, what happened to this teacher? He's not going to throw chalk pieces at me anymore. Oh, we will save so many chalk pieces thereafter. What happens in the apartments? There's no more gossips. There are no more chit-chats. No wasteful talks. Everybody is busy doing their own things. And whatever time is left, they're immediately rushing back to be in that state of peace and meditation because they don't want to lose that. It is so important. I was telling the other day when somebody went to Banaras, he said, how come Banaras people, nobody is talking at all here. Everybody is so silent. And even if you go and hit them on the road because of the traffic, nobody is shouting back at you. Oh, this is really a spiritual place. Everybody is so silent. Anybody, even if you hurt somebody, they are like, okay, so you carry on like that. They don't speak. Then this Panditji said, no, this is not the effect of spirituality of Varanasi, it's the Banaras paan in their mouth. Who wants to spit that paan and shout at you? The joy of chewing on that Banaras paan is so enticing, so amazing. Who wants to lose that and talk to you, whatever you have done? So that is the glory of self-contentment. You're so happy within yourself. It's so beautifully Mundaka Upanishad. I'll conclude with this. It says, prano hi esha yasarva. All this that is there, that I see, it's all prana, vibhati. It shines in everything. The same prana. Today we're doing a Prashnopanishad, but this is from Mundaka Upanishad. This prana, this divine vibrations, this consciousness, this energy of divine, is what makes the birds fly, the sun rise, the trees grow, the rivers flow. So beautiful, it makes you, me walk, talk. It makes everything happen. Pranohi, it's the same prana in everything, which sarva bhutair vibhati, in all beings it shines. The one who comes to know about it, vijanan vidwan, the one who comes to know about this truth, what happens to him? He doesn't start a YouTube channel of his own to tell about it. He doesn't set up a website blog to speak about it. He doesn't even set up a new ashram to promote or propagate it. What happens to him? Vijanat vidwan bhavati naati vadi. He becomes silent. Who wants to lose this beautiful feeling of silence in these empty talks? He becomes silent. Naati vadi. Doesn't want to speak too much. In fact, doesn't want to speak at all. But if duty demands, okay, your teacher says, I don't want to speak in the class, then it is not fair. But to that extent only he speaks, otherwise he doesn't speak. Why? Atma krida Atmaratihi. He is busy in his own self, Atma Krida. He is playing within himself. Atmarati, he is. Rati means enjoying. Where? Inside. He is busy within himself. Kai ke paan banaras wala. Busy within himself. No, nothing to touch his peace. But Kriyavan, he is also active outside. Atmarati, Atma Krida, but Kriyavan. Look at the apparent paradox, so to say. He's so busy, happy inside, hardly speaks much. At the same time, he's very active outside. Because he's doing his duty, dharma as is to be followed according to whatever God's will is. Tesham Brahma Vidam Varishtam, they say. Those are the best of the knowers of Brahman. Who are they? They believe everything is illumined by the same prana, the same consciousness. In the dog, in the rat, in the cockroach, the same consciousness. And once they come to know about it, they are silent. Because that's overwhelming feeling. When you see something so very amazing, you're stunned by it. You're stupefied by it. And you just go silent. No words come out. You don't know how to describe it. So happy. Atmarati, Atma Krida, and he's busy within himself. Mastahati, he's going on about doing his own things. No care of the world. In the sense, care means he's not worried about what others are saying or what others, how they're behaving with him. He is the same to all. But Kriyavan, he'll come to the office on time, he'll do his job perfectly, deliver whatever is to be done, go back again into the same state of. They are the knowers of Brahman who are best. Now, after all these 30 days lecture, if you come to a conclusion, all Swami wants is 24 hours meditation. If you don't show up in the office and somebody calls and saying, where are you? You can't report saying that, you know what, that is enough. I have practiced this distraction for so many births. Here I am practicing the Brahma Jnana. No, because if you are truly a Brahma Jnani, if you are a seeker of Brahman, you will also be Kriyavan, active outside but peaceful inside. Nothing will irritate you. Nothing will instigate you. Nothing will make you react. Because you are always deriving the strength from the peace within. And that practice, practice, practice. It won't come in a day. It won't come in a year. It may not come in this birth also. Does not matter. Even if it comes some births, you will be redeemed. Just practice, practice, practice. That is what is required. A singer said, if I don't practice for one day, I will get to know. If I don't practice for 1 week, my wife will get to know. If I don't practice for 1 month, the whole world will get to know that I have not practiced. My sound, my voice, my singing will show. In 1 day, he himself knows that I have not practiced. 1 day you don't practice meditation, you should know. Today mind is not steady. It's very reactive, it's jumping, it's restless. I'm not feeling that completeness, there is void inside. No, that should drive you back into that state of meditation. And I said, 2 minute meditations are possible, 1 minute meditations are possible. As you're walking, something restless, just sit down under one of the beautiful trees. Make sure there are not too many birds on top. But sit down there. 1 minute meditation, close. I am Brahman. All this is Brahman. This is Jagat, is a Leela. I'm just playing along according to God's plan. I need not irritate myself. I need not frustrate myself. I need not go through all these kinds of turbulences. It is not me. I'm the deep ocean. And I am the ocean of consciousness. And all these are waves. Their nature is to keep moving. But deep inside, waves cannot move the ocean. It is steady. So like that, 1 minute meditation, 2 minute meditation, half a minute meditation. Whenever you feel, just withdraw. That is very powerful, one. Second thing, in your daily life, as a matter of practice, increase your daily practice. Sleep half an hour less. That tamas has not taken us anywhere in these many years or in these many lifetimes. Half an hour less of sleep, Brahma Muhurtam, early morning. And so much of peace. If you're in city, you would have complained. Here, there is no complaint also. So beautiful it is. A devotee said, my house is so restless. So many children are there. My wife alone is enough, but then children are also there along with it. So much of noise. I can't meditate. I can't find a quiet corner. Then this Guruji said, you have cows? He said, yes, we have cows, traditional old times, you see. Oh, then you do one thing. You tie all the cows inside your house. No, 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 they're outside in the goshala. Listen, tie all of them inside the house, he said. All right. So he brought all the cows, tied them inside the house. He came back to Guru, said, now it's even more miserable. You know, as if my wife, children, were these cows all the time, they're making a mess of the house. He said, oh, is it so? I'm so sorry. Take the cows out and tie them back in the goshala. He tied them back in the goshala. Then he came, our house is so peaceful. House was always peaceful if you knew how to be peaceful. So don't give excuses. I have too much work, and therefore, and they called me suddenly for this work, therefore, or I had some problem at home, therefore. Don't give excuses. The excuses are the straight, what you call, sign of lethargy, unwillingness. Excuses are only that. You should find an excuse of how you'll find a time within all your activities to still practice this. If not in a long stretch, at least the 2 minutes, 4 minutes, 3 minutes, wherever you get an opportunity. When it'll happen? When you not practice the other thing. When you don't have to go and chat up with everybody, whomever you meet. When you don't have to use your phones all the time. When you don't have to keep watching the news every 2 minutes. When you don't have to converse unnecessarily, send messages and mails unnecessarily. Just mind your business. What is to be done? Do that. And be done. That's when you'll find time to practice the truth. Because otherwise you'll end up practicing unknowingly, you'll end up practicing untruth. When you engage yourself in all these activities, including too much time spent on grooming, it's like reinforcing your idea that you are the body. Too much time spending in choosing things, it's reinforcing the idea that you are the mind. So set a schedule, set a way, and just follow that all through. And in that also find ways to fit in those 1 minute, 2 minutes as possible. Otherwise, wake up early. Nobody is bothering you. Nobody said don't wake up early. You can wake up early. All I'm saying is don't stay up in the night. That's not right. That is tamas. That's not an ashram culture. Whatever work you have, close it at certain times. Start early in the morning. Nobody will stop you. But don't follow the reverse schedule. So these are some basic things. This is the last lecture on 30 days, this thing. Take it to your heart. Keep it very, very steady in your mind. Let it not slip out of your grip at all because of your carelessness. They are precious pearls. It has the essence of all that one can do in all circumstances and still realize divine. You have heard much. You have understood at least some. And you have practiced a little. Now make it a lifelong habit. And habits form when you keep doing it over and over and over again. It should become a habit to be divine. It should be a habit to be good, to be spiritual. Otherwise, just doing this bhakti bhajana will not lead you too far. Even karma has its own limitations. Jnana alone is ultimate solution to all problems, which will further enhance your bhakti, which will further enhance your karma. Everything will become much better, superlative, because you have also attained that wisdom, at least a little bit of that. Develop these simple habits, day-to-day, daily habits, which should anyway be an ashram's habit. It should be habit of every ashrami also, anywhere, grihastha ashrama, brahmacharya, vanaprastha, sannyas, everybody should have these basic things. Practice the truth, and it means take away all the time from practicing untruth and devote it, donate it, contribute it to the time for practicing truth. And every time mind is again slipping back to the untruth, drag it back. Pratyahara, you have done some practice. And make it a habit. Now these 30 days should continue forever in your life. It should be the way of your life. There is no deviation from this. So tomorrow onwards, we'll just observe bhajans and some maunam. And that's about it. And keep these whatever words are spoken, treasure them and listen to them. And do mananam, do chintanam and didhidhyasanam. And God's grace is there in abundance. He wants everybody to be realized. Then God is the one who doesn't want you to be realized. He wants that only. So he'll be very happy. Tattva bhavo prasidati. When the moment Brahman realizes somebody is trying to know me, attain me, he'll become so happy. And he will rush to reveal himself to the aspirant. Because he wants everybody to know. Otherwise, why did he create this world? He created so that somebody should know that he exists. And therefore, if you put little effort, he'll become happy. And watch these beautiful surroundings and everything, try to see Brahman. In everything, try to see his hidden hand. Try to see him hiding, like Krishna hiding behind doors. Now practice Maunam. Maunam is very, very important. Bahi, outside Maunam, inside Maunam. Now, inside Maunam means not even like reading and scrolling and, you know, mouth is shut, but mind is active. No, cut down on your unwanted contacts and media. And it's just not necessary. Read what is necessary. Everything else is a distractor in the mind. The thought goes in, sits down there and disturbs your sadhana and meditation. Do this practice on a regular basis. Consistency is the key. If you do it consistently, no doubt, but the circumstances are so favorable, the season is so right, and the thresholds are so low. If not now, then when? Said Jesus to his mother. Why are you leaving now? If not now, then when? If not here, then where? If not this way, then which way? This is a question you should put to yourself and follow it very, very strictly.